Hello friends, in today's video, let us learn about an application of radioactivity, which is carbon dating. So let us first go through the basics of radioactivity in order to understand more about carbon dating. Carbon comes in several forms or isotopes. C12, C13, C14, etc. are isotopes of carbon. So C14 is a very rare form of carbon, and it is 14 times as heavy as hydrogen atoms. So these are the different isotopes of carbon that we see commonly: carbon-12, carbon-30 and carbon-40. Now what is radioactive decay? In a radioactive decay, the nucleus of an atom changes into a new element. So if an atom is converted into another element, the proton number must change in a radioactive decay. So then only the decay process will be happening. That means the destruction of the current element, which is decaying into another element, will be happening only if the proton number changes. For example, this is the decay process of carbon-14, C14 getting changed into N40. Now in this process, a neutron changes into a proton. That is happening in the decay of carbon-14. Now how does carbon-14 forms in the atmosphere? We know carbon-12 is the most common isotope of carbon, 6C12. This is the highly available carbon-12 form. But carbon-14 is also present in atmosphere, and it forms when cosmic rays falls on the atmosphere. Cosmic rays that are coming from the sun and distant stars will produce carbon-14 in the atmosphere in addition to carbon-12. Let us first see how carbon-14 is formed in the atmosphere. The cosmic ray, which is highly energetic, can knock neutrons out of atomic nuclei in the upper atmosphere. So when cosmic rays falls on the atmosphere, highly energetic neutrons are emitted from certain atomic nuclei. And these displaced neutrons, which are highly energetic and hence moving very fast, will hit ordinary nitrogen, nitrogen-14, which are present at lower altitudes, converting it into 14 carbon. So this process is actually happening in the atmosphere. Let us see that. So here you can see cosmic rays are falling onto the atmosphere, and they will activate some nucleus to emit high energetic neutrons. And these neutrons, when colliding with nitrogen-14, will form carbon-14. So carbon-14 is present in the atmosphere, and this carbon-14 can combine with oxygen to form carbon dioxide. This is just like the normal carbon dioxide. The only difference is that the carbon in this carbon dioxide molecule is radioactive. It is not C12, it is C14 carbon. Now we know, unlike carbon-12, carbon-14 is unstable. It is radioactive, and it will slowly decay, changing back to nitrogen and releasing energy. So carbon-14 is radioactive. Now ordinary carbon is found in the carbon dioxide in the air, which is taken up by plants, which in turn are eaten by animals. So we know every living being has some amount of carbon inside them. And these carbon usually comes from the carbon dioxide, which is consumed by plants during photosynthesis, and we intake these carbon through eating plants and animals. And so a bone, a leaf or a tree, or even a piece of wooden furniture contains carbon in various forms. And this carbon ultimately comes from the atmosphere. When carbon 14 has been formed, like ordinary carbon, it combines with oxygen to give carbon dioxide, and so it also gets cycled through the cells of plants and animals. So when we inhale, when the plants consume carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, they are consuming both carbon dioxide composed of C12 atoms, as well as carbon dioxide composed of C14 atoms. And while we consume plants and animals which have consumed plants, we are also intaking C12 as well as C14. So in every living being, carbon is present in C12 form as well as in C14 form. So this is the basic depiction. The cosmic rays induce formation of C14, and this C14 can combine with oxygen to form carbon dioxide, and carbon dioxide is taken up by plants, and the plants are eaten by animals, and people eat animals as well as plants, and effectively C14 will be present in all living beings. And how this carbon dating is done? So in carbon dating, we take a sample of air or sample of whatever fossil or whatever thing that we need to count the age. Then we count the number of carbon 12 atoms and the carbon 14 atoms and calculate the ratio of carbon 12 and carbon 14. 14 carbon by 12 carbon ratio. And because 14 carbon is so well mixed up with 12C, we expect to find that this ratio is the same if we sample a leaf from the tree or a part of your body. So in every living being, in tree, in a human being, as well as in the air, the 14 carbon by 12 carbon ratio is a constant. If it is living, that should be noted here. If it is living, then this 14 carbon by 12 carbon ratio will be a constant. And how the carbon dating clock works? And the clock starts working after a plant or animal dies. The plant or animal after death is no longer consuming carbon. So after a plant is dead, it will not be doing photosynthesis, and hence it will not be absorbing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. An animal after death will not be eating, and hence will not be taking up carbon from the surrounding. So whatever be the carbon accumulated within the animal, within the living being, up to its death will be present inside it. And after its death, no more carbon will be taken up by the living being. And after that, since C14 is radioactive, it will continue to decay. But we know C12 is not radioactive. C12 is a stable element and it will not decay. So this is a part of a dead animal, a dead human being, and it is no more taking C14 in or C12 in. But this C14 present inside this living being is decaying due to its radioactivity. So in living things, although 14 carbon atoms are constantly changing back to 14N, they are still exchanging carbon with the surroundings. So the mixture remains about the same as in the atmosphere. So you might think, even now within us, carbon 14 is present, C14 is present. Aren't they also decaying? Yes, they are also decaying at the same rate. But we are continuously taking carbon from the surroundings. As long as a being is living, it is continuously consuming carbon dioxide from the surrounding, which is present in both C12 and C14 form. And as long as an animal is living, the 14 carbon concentration of 14 carbon will be a constant due to this consistent taking up of carbon from the surrounding, from the atmosphere. But as soon as the plant or animal dies, the 14 carbon atom will decay and are no longer replaced, and no longer we are consuming from our surrounding or consuming from the air. So the amount of 14 carbon in that once living thing decreases as time goes on. In other words, 14 carbon by 12 C ratio gets smaller. So we have already mentioned 14 carbon by 12 carbon ratio is a constant for living beings. But after its death, 14 carbon will undergo radioactive decay. But 12 carbon is a stable isotope, and hence 12 carbon, the amount of 12 carbon will not change even after death. So after death, this ratio 14 carbon by 12 carbon will get smaller due to radioactive decay of 14 carbon. So we have a clock which starts ticking the moment something dies. After the death of an animal, the 14 carbon will be continuously decaying, and hence we have a clock. And this clock will work only for things which were once living. So this carbon is taken up by only the living beings. For example, plants consume carbon dioxide, and those living beings that consume on plants or take carbon dioxide directly from the atmosphere can have this clock. And it cannot be used to date volcanic rocks, for example, because they are not taking up carbon dioxide directly from the atmosphere. There are other techniques to measure the age of volcanic rocks. So this is the process that we see here. Cosmic radiation induces the change of 14 nitrogen into carbon 14, which is the radioactive carbon isotope, and it will decay into 14 nitrogen slowly. And the half-life period of carbon 14 is 5713 years, and in 5730 years, carbon 14 isotope will be halved. Half of the amount of carbon 14 will decay. The rate of decay of 14 carbon is such that half of an amount will convert back to 14 nitrogen in half-life period, 5730 years. So in two half-lives, that means in 11460 years, only one quarter of 14 carbon will be left. Thus, if the amount of 14 carbon relative to 12 carbon in a sample is one quarter of that in a living organism at present, then it has a theoretical age of 11460 years. So consider the 14 carbon amount present in a living sample, and suppose if we measure the 14 carbon in a dead sample, in a fossil, and if the amount of 14 carbon in the dead sample is 1/4 of the carbon present in the living sample, then that implies this plant or this sample was dead 11460 years ago, because the decay of carbon 14 into 1/4 of its initial amount will happen in this many years. So according to this clock or this practice, we can calculate the age of samples approximately around the order of 5000, 10,000, etc. If the age is above 50,000 years, then we cannot accurately detect the age, because the carbon 14 will be left only in very small quantities. So radiocarbon dating cannot be used for measuring the age of millions of years. Only up to 60,000 years or 50,000 years, the carbon dating can give you accurate result. So if a sample contains 14 carbon, it is good evidence that it is not millions of years old. If a sample is millions of years old, then surely all the 14 carbon will decay during that period of time. So carbon 14 dating is used only on organic materials, and it cannot be used to date rocks because they are not living beings and they are not taking up carbon directly from the atmosphere, and there is an age limit that we can measure, which is around 60,000 years ago. That is because the half-life is 5730 years. So that is about carbon dating. I hope you understood the concept. Thank you.